Hi, Nikon D50 Teardown and Review Part 3, Mirror Box. If something fails within your camera, statistically, there is a pretty good chance it's gonna be something mechanical and located within this part. So let's take a look and see what's inside of a typical DSLR mirror box. I'm going to disassemble it completely, which while working on a camera I usually don't do because obviously there is no point, but this time I want to show you how complex mirror boxes are. Starting with the shutter. As in many older cameras, shutter is connected by wires. More modern ones have connectors. You can pretty much disassemble them completely and put them back together without using a soldering iron at all. Next is the aperture control mechanism. But before, I'm going to remove the viewfinder just to get it out of my way. Okay, so this is the part that controls this lever on Nikon cameras. It fails relatively often compared to other parts. I think it fails way more often than shutters, depending on the model, but overall most of my customers are very concerned about this shutter. The reality is that there are tons of other parts that can fail inside every single DSLR. And shutter is just one of them. Two more wires to go, and it's out. So these are probably the two most common parts that fail. Moving on. The rest of the viewfinder, pentamirror, just four screws holding it, and two small dots of glue. This glue is called Super X. No adjustments for the viewfinder position in this model, as in most cheap DSLRs. Very important thing about pentamirrors. It's extremely hard to clean the reflective surface without scratching it. The reflective layer is extremely thin, and there are some specific ways of cleaning these, but I don't want to go over it right now. If I have to remove this part while working on a camera, I put it into a clean bag right away, and also make sure that the bag is not touching the reflective surface. Next is an LCD screen. This is the one that's showing you all focusing points when you look through the viewfinder. It's kind of a white non-translucent, but it becomes clear when you apply power to it. You can check this easily with your own camera, remove the battery, and wait for a couple of seconds and the viewfinder will become dark and totally out of focus. It's exactly this LCD screen doing this without power. This one is also easy to scratch, so it's going into a bag. Another LCD screen. This one is showing some information at the bottom of the viewfinder if you look through it. For example, the aperture, shutter speed, battery status, and this type of stuff. Many cameras also have an additional vertical LCD, also showing some information. Yes, a lot of LCDs inside of a typical viewfinder. Small mirror for the horizontal LCD. And the last part of this viewfinder is the focusing screen. Also super easy to scratch. Overall, if I can give you a tip here, if you're doing any DIY repair on your camera, don't remove anything related to the viewfinder. These parts are extremely easy to scratch, much more than any lens, and it's very hard to clean them properly. So if you have a small speck of dust inside, it can easily turn into a lot of junk and dirt, plus possibly some scratches. Don't do it. Okay, so I got rid of all the optics here. Well, there is a mirror and sub-mirror, but this is not a big deal. Overall, I feel more comfortable right now. There is not much left to scratch. Let's continue. Bayonet mount and three springs that are holding the lens attached precisely to the mount surface. Precision here is very important. Lens contacts assembly. I have to desolder some connections here. And very gently take it out, being careful not to tear or destroy this flex cable. The main flex board with a motor driver on it. This one is for the focus motor. Some springs and some other parts. And the autofocus motor is out. Lens release button and the whole mechanism related to it. Mirror and sub-mirror assembly. In this model, these are held just by two metal pins, and these pins are secured by a tiny dot of glue on each one. So let's remove them. Notice the spring that's mounted on the main mirror. It's pushing the sub-mirror to either one of two positions so it doesn't stay in the middle. If this spring fails, and it happens sometimes, the camera is experiencing serious focusing problems. Here you can see the sub-mirror pin. That's getting the sub-mirror into correct position while the main mirror is either open or closed. The aperture lever, with some other parts and springs. This aperture lever also gets damaged sometimes, so it's necessary to replace it. Okay, so pretty much everything is disassembled right now. So it's time for common problems and a quick overview of all the parts. Notice that I'm not touching the focusing sensor, not even touching the screws of the focusing sensor. I do, however, frequently check if there are any signs of liquid damage here, because liquid often gets accumulated under this tape right here, and any corrosion is clearly visible here if you lift this tape. If you don't, you'll never notice it. I also check the whole flex cable if there are any visible signs of corrosion here. Pentamirror. If this part is scratched or damaged in any other way, I would just replace it. It's very inexpensive, but still worth to be careful, as always. Nikon is gonna be very happy not to sell any parts to you, so the only option pretty much is eBay, and this is a very unreliable source of parts. Bayonet mount. This is a high-precision part, even though it doesn't look like. If it's even slightly bent, there is gonna be usually some damage to the plastic frame, and it's a big problem then. I very rarely have to remove this part from camera. Usually don't touch it at all. This flex board, not a lot going on over here, just a motor driver and a bunch of connectors. It's exactly the same motor driver that's on the main board. Now the shutter. This one is very different than in most other cameras. It's totally mechanically disconnected from the rest of the camera. There is no motor, it works only by electromagnets. So unlike in many other cameras, where there is an arm that drives the shutter and there are two curtains that are being held by two electromagnets, releasing one of them first and then the other, this one has only one curtain and there is a locking switch inside that holds this curtain either in fully open or fully closed position. Here you can see just one curtain and there is not much else inside. It's super, super simple. Okay, let's take a quick look inside this part and see how it works. One electromagnet is over here, and this is a rotating magnet that's driving the single shutter curtain. And it's sitting over here, so with some current applied to this coil, it will rotate this piece and drive the shutter curtain open or close. There is also a double switch here that tells the microcontroller the current shutter state. And this is the locking part that prevents the shutter curtain from moving freely. If there is no current applied to this large coil, the shutter will flip open and close easily on its own. You could do it just by shaking your camera, so this locking part prevents it from doing so. And there is no need to keep the current applied. When it's locked in place, it's gonna stay this way. This is the part that fails in this particular shutter design. The round magnet on the bottom starts to rotate against this metal post here, and the locking mechanism is not working properly anymore. It's actually super easy to fix. Quick check if it works correctly after putting it back together, and I also test the locking mechanism. Next is the light meter, or auto exposure sensor. It's all glued together and there are three adjustment screws with springs that allow for correct position adjustment of this whole assembly. Internal focus motor. This is the famous part that's missing in all cheap new Nikon DSLRs like D3000, D5000 series. It's a super cheap assembly, it's all plastic, there are five plastic gears inside, and the motor obviously, and a pulse counter. The build quality is pretty much identical across all Nikon cameras, so a cheap D50 and a Nikon D4 or D800 have pretty much the same focus motor assembly inside. Maybe the shape might be slightly different, but overall, build quality is exactly the same. Super cheap stuff. The aperture control unit. This metal piece is controlling the metal lever that you can see from the outside on your camera body, which controls the diaphragm assembly inside your lens. There are just a bunch of plastic gears inside and a solenoid that locks the aperture lever to a specific position during the mirror box cycle. When I apply some voltage to the solenoid, you can see it moving. And again, it moves. I'll make a separate video about how this stuff works in details, maybe in some more complex case like a D800 or D4. The important part to check during a repair is on the other side. It's this white plastic gear, and there are metal contact brushes on it. So it serves basically as a mirror box position detector. If something is wrong with it, either with the brushes or if there is some dirt on the small PCB here, the camera will definitely show an error, or there could be some other problems. It's worth to check this thing and make sure that the brushes are making a good contact with this small PCB here. Okay, so now I have to put all this stuff back together. I usually don't need to disassemble the mirror box nearly as much as I did here, but again, I wanted to show you how complex these toys are. And here is something I do quite often while assembling things back together. I check them manually, by hand, if they work correctly before putting the motor back in place, so I can make sure that nothing is stuck or nothing is causing problems. I go through the mirror box cycle and see that everything is moving the way it should. The aperture lever, the shutter, when it's connected mechanically, it's going through the mirror box cycle and everything else. This one is not mechanically connected, so it doesn't matter here. And then when I see that everything is fine, I connect the motor and I can be pretty sure that it's going to work fine when I turn this camera on later. Now, putting back the shutter and the viewfinder, and the mirror box is complete again. I hope you liked it, a quick peek of what's inside of a typical mirror box. Of course, they vary in quality and complexity between cameras, but overall the idea is exactly the same. In the next part, we'll take a look at the top cover and the rear cover. Thanks for watching and see you next time.